This is week two of our vision series leading up to next week, which we'll get to in a moment. But last week we talked about you as a person. So real quick recap for those of you that maybe missed some of those, you fell asleep or whatever. Let me recap real quick what it means for you as an individual. See, our vision as a church, right? As a church starts with you as an individual. Right? Oftentimes as the church grows, as we launch out, as we have all these practical things, all these things here, we go up and we go up. Like above an individual, we go, here's where we're reaching a community, right? Our goal is to reach the entire city of Stowe. That's it. One. Thanks, buddy. Look, our goal is to reach the community, right? Like our goal as individuals should be to reach out to the communities and impact the world around us. But it has to start with you as an individual. And we walk through John 15, and it's I am the vine, and you are the branches, right? So as a individual, you have to be a branch first. You have to be connected with God. So we talked about abiding in Christ and how we must stay connected with Him, because as a human, basically, I mean, it is our obligation to bear fruit. God's mandate is that we bear fruit. But when we abide in Him, it is not our, it's our obligation to bear fruit, but it's not our obligation to be the ones that make the fruit. Now, the fruit comes when we abide in Him. So, as a follower of Christ, we must abide in Him, and then He bears fruit through us. So when we have this opportunity, when we abide in Him, we become a conduit all the way to the fruit. But we can't focus on the end with the fruit, right? Our branch has fruit on one end, but the other end is connected to the vine. We have to turn our attention toward the vine, and then from there, we go through. So, that was last week. Yeah, you got it. That was it. That was the Cliff Notes version. Right. Abide in Christ. So as we move this, we're going to, start at the U level, and then we're expanding this out over the next 2 weeks. So this week, we're going to expand to focusing on your family. Okay, so there's our vision for you, and then our vision for your family. Now, there are two types of people in this room right now, okay? One with family in the home and one with family not in the home. Okay, let me say, for those of you that have a family in the home, this is going to be focused. I'm going to say family, I'm going to say home, we're going to build our house, right? But as we go into this, you're going to be like, yes, I get that. If you do not have family in the home, okay, do not check out on me. Okay, this is not an excuse to go take a nap. It's a little grim in here. We might need to turn all the lights on today, right? It is, no, this is where you would transition. Okay, so I don't have my family with me. I don't have my family in the home. You know, maybe your family is not yet in the home. Maybe you live by yourself. You're not married yet. You haven't had kids yet. All those kinds of things. That's one option. Or maybe you are grown up and you live alone and your family's all gone and they've all moved away. And, so listen, you can just change those words of family and home to life. Your life, right? Your interest. Okay, so you with me? You with me? You got me? Okay. Okay. So then next week, this week is all about your family. This week is all about, you building your house, for those of you, right? Right. But next week, we're going to do something a little more unique. This is a unique week next week, okay? You don't want to miss this. I've been pitching for next week, we are a part of New Life Church. Now, New Life Church is not just this location. New Life Church is, we actually have three locations. We have three campuses for New Life Church. Not three locations, because the other two actually technically share a location. But New Life Church has three campuses. We have our Aurora campus, we have our Stowe campus, which you're sitting in, and then we have a campus called New Life Indian Fellowship. And birthed out of New Life Aurora is this Indian Fellowship Church, because in the 10-mile radius of Aurora, the epicenter of where the church, our other campus is, there are 6,500 Indian Americans. There is a great need there, and we have an Indian pastor that is passionate about reaching his people, and so we have brought those two together. We have birthed New Life Indian Fellowship almost a year ago. So we're coming up on the one-year anniversary of New Life Indian Fellowship. So what we did was, last year, the vision of New Life was planting churches, essentially. We planted on Palm Sunday last year, was the official launch of New Life Indian Fellowship. Last September was the official launch of New Life Stowe. And we have come together. So this year, what we wanted to do was come back together. Right? Some of you probably didn't even know that there was another campus, or didn't know that we were a part of a larger church than just what we have here, right? So we have all these moving parts. But what we decided was we needed to come together and have a vision for New Life as a whole. So what we're going to do next week, Pastor Josh, he's the lead pastor over the whole organization. He is going to address the entire New Life family. So via video, we are going to have, now we'll still have that, don't miss it because the video is like, oh, I can see it online. You can. Spoiler alert, you can watch it later than next week, but that doesn't mean you can skip it. I promise, that'd be good. So we're gonna see the vision, hear the vision, digest the vision of what our family as New Life family is all about and where we're going for 2020. And if you don't want to miss it, it's gonna be fantastic. But when we come down to all of this, right, when we come down to, like, distilling down to what it means to be a part of New Life, a part of our church, a part of God's family, all the way down to you, it comes down to we really love God and we really love people. That's what it's all about. That's where we want to land with, knowing that we as a church love people. So today, can we, as we get into our vision for your family, can we pray, can you bow your heads with me, and just open our message with basic prayer. God, we thank you. I thank you for your word. I thank you that your word does not return void, that your word is alive and active, and it does something to us. It changes our hearts. God, I pray that you would be with us today. In the name of Jesus. Amen. So today we're gonna focus on family. But what does it mean? What does it mean to have family? And I have this kind of illustration that we're going to kind of build out today of building your house, right? Most of you live in a dwelling, right? Some of you, I think everybody lives in some sort of home, house, dwelling, apartment, you know, cardboard box, whatever you want to live in is up to you. But today, you know, we're going to build out our house. Right? So, what does it mean to build that? And I feel like maybe the labor that we have can be kind of summarized with our first scripture. We're going to walk through a couple different scriptures today.
But the question that rises is our labor worthwhile? Is our labor in building our house worthwhile? If you have your Bible, turn with me to Psalm 127. Psalm 127. I'm there. Is anybody else there? Minus Mike. If you have your Bibles, turn Psalm 127. If you don't have a Bible, it'll be on the screen. It is on the screen. Harold's on it. Or you can read it on your smartphone, whatever you'd like. So here we go. Psalm 127 says, unless the Lord builds the house, those who build it labor in vain. Unless the Lord watches over the city, the watchman stays awake in vain. It is in vain you rise up early and go late to rest, eating the bread of anxious toil, for he gives his beloved sleep. Behold, children are a heritage from the Lord, the fruit of the womb of the Lord. Like arrows in the hand of a warrior are children of one's youth. Blessed is the man who fills his quiver with them. He shall not be put to shame when he speaks with his enemies in the gate. Unless the Lord builds the house, those who build it labor in vain. Are you building your house? Are you laboring in vain? Like, I remember, so I grew up, right, in a 1803 farmhouse. So we had a variety of additions and changes that have happened in our house because some code has changed a little since 1803. I don't know if you know that, but technology and, you know, electricity. So we had oil lamps originally. Like, we still, when we moved in, there were still some of those things. But there was also, like, additions that were put on. So, you know, you go to one of those houses that has had an addition, and you walk in, and you would never know that there was an addition there. And you walk in, and it's almost like the house was built that way without an addition, and you could never tell that there was anything more than the original plan. You know what I'm talking about? But then there's those houses that you feel like the addition was built in Georgia, brought up and duct taped onto the side of the house, and you're like, dude, Lord, who built this? How did you not measure? That was my house, right? So we had, you know, you had these, like, awkward, like, little steps in random places that you're like, this is not the same as that. Right? Unless the builder builds it through the Lord, unless the Lord builds it, we labor in vain. It's like an addition put on a house that doesn't belong. It looks funny. It doesn't match. Right? When Carrie and I then first got married, we used a lot of building and, you know, home illustrations today, okay? Forgive me. We had a little apartment. It was probably somewhere around 400 square feet. Right? This little one bedroom, one bath. Like, the kitchen was like this hallway with a stove and a sink, and like 4 inches of countertop, right? And for us in that moment, when we first got married, we did everything we could just to get enough stuff in there to survive, right? We're like, man, this is so much space. I can run in circles. And, you know, and then we had that place, and then we expanded a little bit, so we moved into a bigger place. And then we moved, listen, we have moved more times, not because we're nomads, just because of, like, you know, you go to different places, you upgrade apartments for a little while, and then we bought a house, and we sold a house, and we bought a house, and sold a house, and we moved here, and bought another house. And so this past, it was almost a year ago that we moved for the most recent time. We moved into our house, and then we moved from Toledo. We started packing all this stuff we get so much stuff. You all laugh
because you know. Yeah, you just accumulate, and all of a sudden you're like, I don't even know what. I'm pretty sure that there are like random little elves that just bring junk in and throw it in my storage closet or in my garage. And like, I don't know where this came from, but it's just here. Like, we build our house, we fill our lives that way sometimes. We fill our lives with all of this stuff. And we don't realize how much stuff accumulates over time until we try to move or clean or just reorganize. So I want to build out this illustration for the day. And I made a craft project, okay? Does anybody actually craft in here, like for real craft? Please don't judge me. Okay. This is the best I could do in about 15 minutes. But I made for us an illustrated house. This is my house. Okay. You don't have to clap. That's like, that is all a pity clap. I don't need pity claps. So here's my house, right? So we have Carrie, as I got done with it, I sent Carrie a picture. And she's like, why don't we just use a dollhouse? And I was like, because the dollhouse is really, they're too narrow. So what we have here, okay, we have to put stuff in there. So we have this house, right? And we have things. I'm going to set some of this down for a second. Because I have to get in here. So right, we get our house, and you know what's one of the essential parts of a house is food, right? So you have your milk, you have some food, some pies, that's an essential thing. You know, milk, right? So you guys are all like, why didn't you put this random Tupperware thing over here? Right? So when you have your house, you have to have a table, right? So I don't. Because I really didn't want to, like, bend over. So you have your table. So any of you that use a picnic table in your kitchen, you know, creative. So when Carrie and I first got married, right, so we got a pet, right? Do you guys get pets at your house? Like, yeah. Our first dog's name was Weston. He was a Yorkie. He's no longer with us. But Weston, he needed a place to go, right? So you got a little patch of grass. Right here, we'll put Weston. We now have two dogs who are the coolest dogs ever. Remy and JoJo. So then you get kids, right? I didn't actually mean to pick that up and say kids. You don't hit the, please don't hit kids with bats. That's against the law. Right? So you get kids. This is what I meant to get. And kids bring stuff. Like strollers. You know, and then because you have kids, you have, you know, more food in the house. Right? So you start filling your life. So then, you know, you have to go on vacation at some point. So you gotta, you know, you go to the beach. And then, you know, your kids get involved in, you know, playing with toys and, you know, trucks. That one's gonna have to go on the bottom or I'm gonna collapse my house. Right? And then, you know, we started getting into sports with our kids, right? Now, I have two girls, so we don't play football, but, you know, we watch it. But Lily has gotten into volleyball, right? So Lily's into volleyball, but Emery's not into volleyball. Emery's into basketball. So we have basketball and volleyball in our house. But then we also, you know, our kids also like music. This is, there it is. This is Emery's ukulele. So you have music in your house. I
not going to stay in it. I'm just sticking in the attic. Right? And then your kids turn 16. Right? And then they have to, so they learn to drive. They get into other things, right? So maybe it's not sports. Maybe they get into, I couldn't think of anything that would do like theater, so I have a costume of a penguin, right? So your kids get involved in this and that, and then they go on vacation, and, you know, then your kids get bigger and they need even more food, right? So there's even more in there. We're going to bounce it on a football. Right? There's some more in there. And this is how our lives get developed. I think that's it, right? There we go. And then these are the greatest things in the book. You can put stuff in them and then stack them. Beautiful. But then we get to this point. And we go, we have all of this stuff. But at some point, we have to put God in there. And we look at our lives, and we look at everything, and we're falling apart because there's so much going on that we go, I just don't know where this fits. This is my study Bible that I got from our launch, and it's a larger book than the one that I usually used to preach with. It's a little more streamlined. Same words, actually same translation, but it's got more stuff and more notes. And we try to then, like, then we go, well, maybe I can just put a condensed version in instead. And we condense down God into these, like, opportunities or options or the idea that, well, maybe he'll just tuck in on the side. You know that the national average in America, of active church attendance is 1 in 5 weeks. Now, Americans honestly aren't lazy. But what we have is we've been so consumed with everything we have that how do we compartmentalize, and we compartmentalize our life, and then we put God in a compartment instead of being the whole house. And it comes down to, man, now I don't say that the national average of 1 in 5 to convict or make you feel bad or condemn any of you for that. Because our lives are so chaotic, because of our lives being the way they are. Honestly, that's the reason why we try our best to record services so that if you miss one, you can still participate. But what happens is we get so consumed that we go weeks on end and we go, man, when was the last time I even opened my Bible? When was the last time I had an experience with God? When was the last time I was able to do that? And we build our house. We build our house. We build our house. We build our house. And all of that in vain. Unless the Lord builds the house, we labor in vain. And what if we reprioritize the way this happens? What if we could restructure our house and not labored in vain? What if we restructure our lives and it wasn't labored in vain? What if we could take back all that has been given and say, God, let me abide in you first. Restructure our lives, build on it. You know, when we talk about that interpersonal connection that we have, that individual, like our lives are built or should be built abiding in Christ. But there's so much more to that than just your relationship with God. Like, there's a lot more that depends on you. There's a lot more at stake than just your relationship with God right now. There's a lot more that this falters when it's consumed with other things. When your house is built by the Lord, it changes the outcome for a lot more than just you. There's a lot more at stake than just your house. Building your house is more than just you. And honestly, it's more likely even that for you, it's more than just who lives in your house. One of my parenting fears, to be honest, just like family talk today, right? One of my parenting fears, like being a pastor, you know, my kids are at church a lot. Like, some weeks every day. My girls have clean toilets here. Right? That's the life. But one of my fears for my kids is what I would call the Eli issue. Okay, this isn't a coin thing. This is just something that is in my heart. This is something that has been a fear of mine. It's a fear, but it's something that I address, right? It's not something that cripples me. It's something that I think for all of us, if you abide in Christ, if you live your life and you are doing your best to labor your house, not in vain, but letting God build your house, that we can all have that same concern and address that concern. Because the Eli issue is from 1 Samuel. So Eli is a temple priest. So he lives, he works, he's in the temple. So 1 Samuel gets brought to him, and he's raised by Eli. And Samuel becomes a fantastic prophet. He has two books named after him. You're important to have one book, but then two, it's a big deal. He becomes a great force in the land of Israel. And that's not where the tragedy comes in. That's not what concerns me, because Samuel is not Eli's son. But Eli has two sons, Hophni and Phinehas, which are the craziest two names, and that's a dynamic duo right there, Hophni and Phinehas. Hophni and Phinehas followed along, and they were priests under their father. But the tragedy comes in the description of Hophni and Phinehas. 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 12. Now the sons of Eli were worthless men. They did not know the Lord. The sons of Eli, this guy, this holy man, he lived, he worked, he breathed, he ate, slept, and lived temple life. Arguably one of the holiest men there would be in that day. And his son, his offspring, his heritage, his life is remembered for my two sons who were worthless men and did not know the Lord. It's a tragedy. That aches when it comes down to it. Because as a parent, as a follower of Christ, as wherever you want to be on that spectrum, that abiding in Christ, if I am not fully engaged, I fear that. Where does my house rank? Because laboring, building your house, is not about filling it with things. It's about carrying on beyond just you, beyond just your moment. But there's hope, right? That just got real heavy real fast. I want to give hope. I want there to be more because there is more. The gospel changes us, and it can change not just us, not just our house, because our house is not just us right now. Our house is our heritage. It's where we came from. Our house is from long before us. And our house is our legacy, and it's long after us. Carrie, my wife, has had a unique heritage because her grandfather, I think great-grandfather, started the church that she grew up in. A church that, to this day, her parents still go to. Generation after generation, there's a legacy that has been built. There is more to our abiding in Christ than just our moment here. And it comes from, my hope comes from Joshua 24. If you've heard Joshua 24, if you've ever walked through Hobby Lobby, you know Joshua 24. Right? As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Now, that is very nice. It is a very good sentiment to have, to hold on to. As for me and my house, I will hang a plaque on my wall that says it. And I will have a wreath out my door and other things that Hobby Lobby have. Listen, they have capitalized on this, and that's good. But you don't even have to follow God to have a wreath on your door that says, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Your house does not serve the Lord as a building, as a picture. As for me and my house, let's walk through this. This is a bigger moment than just him going, I'm a third guy today. This is a bigger moment because Joshua, we can trace back. He talks through Egypt. So you have these people, the Hebrew people that became the nation of Israel. They went to Egypt, were in Egypt, living, and then became enslaved. And then they were enslaved for 400 years. Right? You know, you think back math-wise, that's a lot of generations. That takes us back 400 years to 1600. 400 years, they were enslaved. They exited with Moses. Second book of the Bible is Exodus. It talks through that process. For 40 years then, they wandered the desert as a people group. Hundreds of thousands of them wandered the desert for 40 years. Now, don't know about you, but if they grew up and all they knew for generation after generation after generation after generation, all they knew was Egyptian understanding. All they had was Egyptian training. All they had was Egyptian culture. And then they just left. 40 years is not going to erase that. For years, they wandered the desert to get rid of the understanding of what it meant to be Egyptian, an Egyptian slave, to now becoming the nation of Israel. And as the nation of Israel, they now have walked through the promised land, because before they even went to Egypt, God gave them a promise that says, I will give you this land. And then those people died. Generations died and went. And then 40 years of wandering in the desert. And then they went into the land that God had promised them. And in the land that God had promised them, they had to drive out the people that were there. And God pushed all of those people out. And Joshua then comes at the end as a beaten and battered and war-torn leader. Lots of battles, lots of wars were fought and won. Then he comes to them and says, God took us out of Egypt and led us to the Red Sea, and he separated the Red Sea by miracle, and he brought us through. And then he drove out all the people in the land and brought us in. And then he says, Joshua 24:14, now, therefore, fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in faithfulness. Put away the gods of your fathers, serve beyond the river and in Egypt. Serve the Lord. If it is evil in your eyes to serve the Lord, choose this day whom you will serve. Whether the gods of your fathers served in the region beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites whose land you dwell in now. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Choose who you want to serve. Pick today who your priority list has. Knowing the fact that God did this for you, and then God did this for you, and then God separated the land. All those gods that were served by the Amorites, he beat all of them and pushed them out so that you could have the land. But if you think those gods are better, serve them. But as for me, today, I'm going to make the choice. I'll draw the line in the sand and say, okay, here it is. Here's who I will serve, and not just me, but my house. All of my relatives, all of those offspring that of my offspring that are still here with us, all of my household, we will serve the Lord. Anyone that I have influence on will serve the Lord. And you know what's interesting about this? It's not just that it comes down to that. But that still in verse 24. This is the last chapter, not verse 24. Chapter 24. Last chapter in the book of Joshua. It ends with his death, but it says this, verse 31. This is so hopeful for us. This is critical right now. Israel served the Lord all the days of Joshua, and all the days of the elders who outlived Joshua had known all the works that the Lord did for Israel. The heritage of Joshua is not just that at the moment that he said, I draw a line in the sand, today we will serve the Lord, but it is long past. Anyone that he had influence on continued to serve the Lord after his death, because he chose for his house to be built and labored by God. Seth, if you want to come up with Dennis, I want us to supposed to wrap up in a unique way today. If you are here alone, you're going to fly solo on this. If you're here with a spouse, we're going to do a little project, okay? This isn't the end-all thing, so if your spouse isn't here with you, or, you know, maybe you're sitting alone and your spouse is playing guitar, right? This isn't the end of this. But here's what I want us to do today. We're going to make a priority list for your house. And maybe this is a moment that you can kind of draft up some ideas, and then your spouse and you can get together. This is going to be homework then, right? Like in school, you know, you want to get it done before the bell rings so that you don't have to take it home and do it. Right? You're going to have to take this home. Okay? But here's the deal. My daughter plays volleyball. Thank you.